Megalithomania Revisited. Artists, antiquarians and archaeologists at the old stone monuments. A presentation by John Michell. In this lecture, John gives a fascinating account of the excavators, scientists, theorists and artists who have fallen under the spell of the stones for centuries and been infected by Megalithomania. Recorded live at Megalithomania Conference 2007.
Thanks, John. Thank you. We had an extraordinary experience over these 2 days of hearing extraordinary and wonderful lectures by original thinkers and researchers. This is something you couldn't get anywhere else, any other gathering, only here at Megalithomania Conference at Glastonbury. You certainly couldn't get anything like it in any of the institutions of education or universities or colleges anywhere in the world, really. So it seems to me that with this outburst of megalithomania, which has been a repeated episode throughout our history, this rediscovery of prehistoric origins and roots and so on, these movements have always been associated with Druids. Oh, we have the first slide there. Is that focus, that slide?
Falling in.
And there are some Druids. It actually shows Caractacus, a British leader, who took refuge among the Druids and was receiving a party of British soldiers on the left. And this was done in 1799 to illustrate a poem, which was very popular at the time, the poem Caractacus. And of course, the whole revival of Druidry, or interest in Druids, rather like as Ronald Hutton said this morning, it really begins with that great master of megalithomania, William Stukeley. We will come to him later on, because first of all, megalithomania, that means, of course, enthusiasm for, or crazies for, or obsessive interest in megalithoi, great stones. That is, specifically old stone monuments and old earth monuments and such, but all the relics of the puzzling relics of the past. And it's megalithomania is it's a form of it's spread the same as the antiquarianism, and it's related, of course, to archaeology, but really very different from it. In one way, it's not destructive or intrusive. It's done in the amateur spirit. Amateur means a lover. It's the spirit of loving the sites and the monuments which we're investigating, not just treating them as objects of research to be expended and investigated and then left to their own devices. But megalithomania surely is bringing love and an amateur, non-professional attitude to these studies. And therefore it's done in a really in a communal spirit, in a social spirit, in a spirit of fun and enthusiasm. No one makes a fortune out of it or makes money out of it. It's done for non-professional reasons. And that's why there's far more interest and progress in studies of antiquity through megalithomania and through antiquarianism than could ever be achieved by the professors of academic institutions. It's like everything in this country worthwhile seems to be done by individuals and in groups, inspired and enthusiastic, rather than by government agencies. Just for one example, the canal and railway preservation movement, all these came entirely against government policy by enthusiastic groups. The same thing with the whole conservation movement in the country and such. And megalithomania is a good example of what can be done by individuals. We've heard experts on so many different subjects, knowing each of them knowing more than is taught in any college. So I'm very much a partisan for the megalithomania approach to the past, because it allows us to use imagination to say what we like without fear of being, or it should be, without fear of being, being given a hearing and be able to express oneself. The particular object of my Megalithomania rarely, I think it's honed in really on the Bronze Age, from about, I suppose, about 1600 or 2000 onwards. It depends how you date it. Beres Velis puts it at about the beginning of the building of Stonehenge in its present form. The Bronze Age seems to me to be, it corresponds to the archaic age of Greece before the classical age, before the temples were built, which the Greeks and other look back to as being the height of their culture, when society was in appearance simple, but guided by high principles and high knowledge. And I think in England, that the age that comes before the Bronze Age, when the really great works in stone and particularly in earth were accomplished, and the great works of surveying were accomplished across Britain, that seems to be like the Arcadian Age. The Bronze Age is very magnificent. If you read Aubrey Bowles' unjustly neglected book, Stonehenge, written some years ago, and Burl, as Ronald Hutton said earlier, really is one of us. He's an enthusiast. He gives a most poetic description of the Bronze Age, the early years of Stonehenge. The great works in gold, gold was everywhere, and you can still see it in museums, the wonderful gold objects produced at that time, and the crafts were at their height. The skilled arts of agriculture and other economies seemed to be practiced at their height. There was a large population, and there was something heroic and splendid about the society in those days. It seemed to be highly ritualized, but it's also scientific. If the Bronze Age people put up a stone somewhere, it was meant to be put there. It was that position. It was absolutely right. In some ways, it reminds me of the Victorian Age when British surveyors going around the world and mapping things very accurately. And one of the great arts of prehistoric times, particularly the Bronze Age, and before that, I think, which has been very much neglected, is the art of surveying. We hear a lot about prehistoric astronomy. That, of course, is very largely is bound up with surveying. And some of the great works of Britain, which are not recognized as being artificial, come from the time before the Bronze Age. For example, one of the first great works that attracted my attention was what I called at that time the St. Michael line. That axis across the longest line you can draw across southern England, from the extremes of East Anglia, actually the actual point, I believe, is the Norfolk-Suffolk border. And here in parenthesis, I'll say that when you're looking at landscape geometry and landscape patterns and such on that great scale, county divisions, particularly at the sea, county boundaries, particularly at the sea, are very important. I find that in the pattern over ancient Ireland, where the provinces meet at the sea, those are the points which are the crucial ones. And in this St. Michael line, the eastern point is the eastern Suffolk, is the Suffolk-Norfolk border, and then the line goes straight down to the Land's End, going over, of course, the Tor or a Mump, which give the actual line, right over the Cheek Spring and other similar sites on the way down to Land's End. But actually, I saw in Bartholomew's Gazetteer, a look at Icknield Way, and it said it was defined by old antiquarians as the line from East Anglia down to Land's End, a straight line. So it's actually the Icknield Way. And the legends of these ancient roads, like the Icknield Way, the Foss Way, and so on, goes back, it's recorded in the old British chronicles, repeated by Geoffrey of Monmouth, about the old dynasty of kings, the Trojan kings, who laid out straight roads from cape to cape, opposite cape of Britain. And on these roads were sanctuaries. They were between the sacred places, and they were so sacred that it's really why highway robbery is such a taboo, because it's a sacrilege. And on these roads, that they were sort of linear sanctuaries, and it was boasted that a child not speaking English or young men not speaking English with no money could travel from one end of England to the other without being molested and meeting hospitality wherever he went. It seemed they had stations. Alfred Watkins was a great etymologist. He said they were the cold harbours. There's a lot of these cold harbour names. I think there's one in Bristol. There's plenty of them around. They may have been the site of stations on the way. So I now refer to the, we call the St. Michael line, as the Icknield Way. And then I just found that similar features can be found in all northern landscapes. That is the axis line, the longest line you can draw across the country, but usually from the northernmost point to the southernmost point. In the Icknield Way, it's from the east, furthest east to the furthest west, the longest line you can draw. And these axis lines seem to represent the symbolic pole of the country. That is, on which everything revolves. It's an imitation of the world pole on which everything revolves. That, of course, is only a concept. And indeed, these straight axis lines are also concepts. But they were clearly, they were marked particularly by the ritual center. Now, the ritual center of southern England is undoubtedly Avebury. And the land around Avebury was very much like the land around Delphi, the corresponding site in Greece, the national sanctuary. It was sacred to the priests who cultivated it. And it was the Mecca, Kebla, for pilgrims from all over the country, and people with business. There was great fairs there, and there was great festivals, trading, competitions, games and such, held throughout the year, rather like Delphi was the locus of the Olympic Games, the national games. So Avebury was undoubtedly the correspondent of that in southern England. And there's two strange things. Well, one thing which links Delphi and Avebury, rather remarkably, that is their geographical positions. Now, it seems to be that the ancient surveyors divided the earth into lines of longitude parallel to the equator, and there were seven main bands, and so it was divided that the 90 degrees from the equator to the North Pole were divided into seven bands. And the second of those bands is Thebes, the ancient Egyptian capital, that's right on it. The three-sevenths is between Mount Olympus and Delphi, and four-sevenths, that is the line, the four-seventh line from the equator to the North Pole, it runs through Avebury, runs through pretty well the center of Avebury. And that is latitude 360 over 7 degrees, because if you were to start walking from the equator northwards, then through the north and south poles, by the time you got to Avebury, you'd have covered 1/7 of that distance. So it's 4/7 from the North Pole, from the equator to the North Pole, and 1/7 of the whole distance around the meridian. And Avebury is also, of course, marked out by the Icknield Way, or Michell Line, passing through it on its way to Glastonbury Tor. These axis lines, I say, seem to me to be a sign that they were laid out by a society which was, I call, cosmologically ordered in accordance with the heavenly pattern. And that involves all kinds of divisions and a number code which is universal. We were able to find out some years ago, we were able to discover some years ago the exact values of the ancient units of measure, the ancient feet and so on. And that study has been greatly developed by John Neal, who's here today, who I suppose is the world-leading authority on metrology. We have quite a number of world authorities here among us today, you know. He's really the leading authority because you know, the only ones who use the foot as a, and the mile as a basic standards. When you do that, the whole thing becomes clear. It's all a number code. If you were to use a meter, a newfangled invention, which means nothing, then all you get is a string of meaningless numbers. But when you're using the right measures, that's probably the same for all the sciences. If they were using the right units of measure, they'd soon discover the unified code behind all natural phenomena. But in this limited field of measure, we can be very precise now on what the ancient measures were. It's the most extraordinary study because it really gives us access to that mysterious object, the canon, or the key to the codification of number, which Plato refers to several times. And Socrates refers to that pattern in the heavens, which you can see for yourself and found in yourself. In other words, the ground plan of the ideal constitution. Now, these constitutions, which actually, I described this in a book, first in a book with Christine Roan called 12 Tribe Nations, and then in a book called At the Center of the World, about world centers and the axis which ran through every country. This is a universal phenomenon. I've seen it, I found it, as far as I have access to the data all over the world, that countries were laid out to imitate that pattern in the heavens. First of all, take the case of Ireland. The people are divided into two. There's a division of Ireland into two. The Great Wall, that great earthwork, it goes across it. Then it's divided into four provinces. Each of those provinces are divided into three. And the state pattern was that the king and the courtiers and the court, the king and the court and the judges and such, would have a perpetual assize, as it were, going round each of those 12 quarters in turn, holding court in each of them every month. And of the four main quarters, that was the great quarterly meetings, where, like at Avebury, there were competitions, games, judgments, and all the business of state. But it was kept on the move in imitation of the sun going through the cosmos. King Solomon said to have been lodged by each of the 12 tribes in turn, meaning he went round the 12 tribes, holding court in each, in imitation of the heavens. That's one aspect of the state pattern. And with it went the division of the national myth into 12 parts, like the King Arthur myth or the Gilgamesh myth. That's divided. They're all divided into 12 episodes. And each of these was located in a separate a 12th division of the country, which is also, of course, astrologically determined. And similarly, the music, the 12-part chant, set the tone for the music, the folk music heard at the festivals. Meanwhile, there seems to be at the center a kind of abbey where there was a perpetual chant kept up, which was imitated in the tone of the music in the 12 sections. That's why we have different folk music, it seems, in different places. And what astonished the old folklorists, like Bering, like Cecil Sharp and others, when they began collecting it 100 or more years ago, that all this folk music was in what they call correct mode, Mixolydian mode or something like that. In other words, it was instituted. The words of these songs, the local songs, have become the popular songs, but the music still maintained its musical integrity. I must get on. You know, going back to Megalithomania, I meant to say, perhaps I did say, it's always associated with the revival of Druidry. And here, by chance, at this conference, we also have had yesterday the finals of the Bardic contest held by the Glasgow Druids, a leading light among whom is my new dear wife, Denny, dear young wife. She's a young grandmother, so that's all right. And I think and a leading light before was Rollo Moffling. So, but this revival is very strong. You saw it last night. The quality of the bardistry and such—it's really impressive. And the competition for this bardic chair. And at the same time, here we have a conference devoted to megalithomania. Well, somehow these two are inseparable companions, megalithomania and druidry. And here, if you can This doesn't seem very clear, this slide, but I don't know if you can see it better over there. Can you see all the apparatus? Oh, I haven't got my glasses on, that was why. Do you see all the apparatus of Druidry, the oak tree with the mistletoe, the sickle, the stone altar or dolmen, the priest behind it, the stone circle, the circle, little semicircle of huts around it, and this sort of lay or avenue through the forest, which I think is very probably realistic what it was like, leading towards a distant dolmen or rocking stone, and what looked like pilgrims or lay hunters or priestly figures coming along that little avenue. So whenever there's an outburst of megalithomania, it seems to me the same images recur. The first one, as I indicated, was by William Stukeley. And then there's another one at the beginning of last century, the 20th century, instigated largely by Sir J. Norman Lockyer, the Astronomer Royal and founder of Nature. And he also saw, realized that all the temples, classical temples, were orientated towards sunrise or certain stars or the sun or moon. And then he found, when he came to Britain and went to Stonehenge, he established, he did a book called Old Stone Monuments Astronomically Considered, which caused quite an outburst of interest, not just among archaeologists. It didn't really interest them at all because they didn't really like it. But Lockyer brought in folklore and the dates of festivals, and he caused quite an outbreak of megalithomania in groups of people looking for sunrises and astronomical effects at stone circles. And also with it came revival of Druidry, particularly in Wales, where nationalistic antiquarians and often clergymen joined in these researches. Lockyer was very much, very, very savaged later by the archaeologists who didn't like the idea of astronomy attributed to the ancient people. Because by that time, the theory of evolution had got such a hold that we thought that people, even a few generations back, were stupider than ourselves. And as for the ancients, they were supposed to be almost like apes. You see them in archaeological pictures. There was someone called Alan Sorrell, wasn't it? He's a good drawer, but he painted the ancient Britons all covered in skins and dropping stones around and sort of acting like barbarians. And that was the image of it. So none of them liked this contradictory image of what Atkinson, that good old archaeologist who died some years ago, called barbarians with brains. I suppose he meant by barbarians people who didn't live, weren't civilized and lived in cities. And that extent, it's a proper description. But I see them more as Arcadians, people who lived simply. They knew how to do it because they had a culture and a science. They knew how to live very well without the onerous burdens of prisons, palaces, and large buildings. And of course, what we know about the noble Druids was that they didn't have temples, but they met in the open air. And indeed, open air courts and assemblies were a feature of Saxon life inherited from the natives and lasted for some time. They always had all meetings and law courts were in the open air. And when I was talking about these axis lines, you can find at the center of them, very often right at the very center, the old ritual center. For example, in Shetland, I went to once, the axis of the main island is about 42 miles long, and it's pretty well due north-south. Precisely halfway along that line is a little islet, a little rocky islet in a loch, only a few yards offshore. And that was the High Court of Shetland. They had 12 courts around the islands of the country. At midsummer, they all came together to what the Norse call the Althing, rather like I described at Avebury, there was festivals and judgments and laws were made and court cases were heard and the law was rehearsed, was recited. But it was placed at the center of the country on that pole, giving authority to whoever was installed there and such, giving authority to the judges, who of course represented the 12 gods of Odin, or the 12 classical gods of the Olympians. And then I find this shown in the center of the world, other examples, many have turned up since. You put it beyond doubt that there were these axes discovered by surveying, and the central point, if possible, if it was suitable, was chosen as the national center. Avebury is slightly off the center, halfway point of the Icknield Way or Michael Line. But you can see why, because the actual center is near Trowbridge is quite unsuited, whereas Avebury is absolutely ideally adapted with its springs and hills and its whole configuration. It's not a like burst of megalithomania not so long ago, when Martin Brennan was in Ireland. He wrote the book The Sun and the Stones and the Boyne Valley Vision, and that got people very excited, and he had a team of young followers, and they used to go and watch out in mounds to see that record the sun rises. And I've been with them, seen the sun coming into a mound in Loch Crew. I forget what it's called now. It's called Canteep. It's got another name, Olafola's Mound, they used to call it. Olafola was a head professor in the Druid College. And we saw at the equinox the sun coming in, its beam narrowed by the entrance. And then it became it narrowed to a very small beam, rather like the lecturer's torch, you know, the little beam of light. It hit the backstone, which was carved with symbols, and then as the sun moved, the ray of light moved in the opposite direction, picking out the symbols one by one, as if spelling out something in a language unknown. But you can see how it's picking out symbol after symbol, and it's arranged to do this. There were a great feature of, I think, Bronze Age life was a great drama, which was enacted with the help of the sun and moon, where places were lit up, where figures were seen to be like giants or like dwarfs. There was tremendous illusions going on. A glimpse of it, that book by Scully, American Yale professor, was it called The Earth, the Temple and the Stones, I think it was. We took many photographs of his researchers in Crete, mainly in Crete. We'd see how the use of light and shadow would create illusions and point out the particular place which was being emphasized, or the particular simulacrum character in the rocks, which was being emphasized in the myth of the time. And you actually see it at Avebury, where you go to near the obelisk, you can just see the top of Silbury Hill. I think it's Paul Devereux pointed that out to me, actually, to him credit. And it's absolutely true. You can just see the top of Silbury Hill. So figures on it would look unusually, with a light behind them, would probably cast shadows. I can see the opportunity for a great drama of light and shadow. And I'll show you one or two pictures of that later on. Now, in 1965-66, I was doing a book called The Flying Source of Vision, and the subtitle was The Holy Grail Restored, because it was a book about the UFO phenomenon. It was inspired by two great philosophers, really, but one was the most obvious one was Carl Jung, who in 1959 wrote that remarkable book, his last book, and his most prophetic book, called it Flying Saucers, and which he said that the myth of things seen in the sky, which he said the appearance of these phenomena in the sky is indicative of changing patterns of thought, a change in the outlook which had been adopted, the materialistic outlook of Western industrial societies, and the coming of a new way of thinking, more in accordance with necessities of the age. And also he said that when these great changes in thought, great changes in the constellations come about as one age gives way to another, so you get signs and wonders and phenomena which are both indications of change and actually agents of it. I thought, that's marvelous. Of course Jung is right. And so I did this book because I could see the time that things were changing. And another prophet at that time was Albert Hofmann, who in 1943 discovered acid, or LSD, whatever you call it, lysergic, what's it called, lysergic? No, LSD anyway. And being in 43 and the war raging around him, Switzerland, where he was rather, he was a pharmaceutical professor, wasn't he? War raging around him, Switzerland rather cut off. So he tried this LSD on his colleagues, Swiss and German professors. And in his book, he describes their reaction. It's most interesting. Being German professors, they were very hard-minded. They tried to hold out against the effects of this drug he came across. But after a bit, the patterns took over, and they were swept away, and their whole mental patterns were broken down. And instead, they got something so much wider, so much better, so much more complete, that they were delighted by it. Hoffman said, no need to take it much, just have that experience and take it seriously and see what you see and work with it. And he deplored, of course, the recreational use of it by which many people came to grief, of just doing it again and again and having sensations. It's a bit like refusing an invitation and receiving the invitation over and over again and never taking the opportunity of going any further with it. But Hoffman said this provides exactly what is needed. He said the same as Jung, that what is needed is to make sense of the future, to have any future, is a complete reversal, a revolution, a complete change in the way we're thinking now towards a more complete view of the world, which takes into account consciousness and the living nature of the earth and the world and our environment. And he said that LSD is something which will help anyone to make that step. Gosh, how right he's been proved, I think, and Jung too. So that book was dedicated to those two people, Jung and Hoffman. But while I was writing it, I came across Watkins and Lays, completely unknown at the time, except to a small group. I heard it first from Jimmy Goddard, a young ufologist. He and a few other ufologists had come across it, and they were connecting Lays with UFO sightings. I wasn't in touch with that group at the time, though I did hear it in a short lecture given at the Kensington Library to a UFO group by Jimmy Goddard. I went and looked up Watkins' book, and again, I was in another world, because Watkins was such a gentle, sane, humanistic, modest, a very beautiful writer, a man who was steeped in the traditions of his local country. And he saw for himself, he did have an insight where he saw the country laid out, as it were. And he very bravely, without any fear, did his book, developed his followers. It was on print. I had to get it at the library at the time. I brought it into print later on, and other books of Watkins's and to do with Lays. And I think The Flying Saucer Vision was the first book to mention Lays, since the war. And then I came across other things like the Chinese feng shui and geomancy and the way in which the land is laid out to be like an imitation of paradise, and certain spiritual considerations are taken into account in the arrangement of the landscape. Feng shui later on became a fashion, was taken up by interior decorators and became a stupid and expensive fad, because it's not really designed for personal gain or use, so that's part of it, but it's designed for the whole country. The whole of China was made into a great garden, into a place of harmony, in touch with the heavens and with the influences of heaven by the use of feng shui or geomancy. And I see the same had been done in this country, because there's traditions of it everywhere. Then 2 years later, after 67, when I did The Flying Saucer Vision, and that which first book to bring in actually folklore and such in connection with UFOs, then I had to follow the lay thing more, did a tremendous amount of research. I was alone at that time in the subject, and I came up with this book, The View Over Atlantis. I took Atlantis as a sort of metaphor of the lost, great lost civilization. Not so much physically lost as lost out of our sight. We can't see it anymore. Rather like a poet A.E. said, and other poets have said the same thing. I realized then the golden age was all around us. It's never lost, never gone. We just become blind to it. The View of Atlantis sort of set out all the subjects which later developed into, they call Earth Mysteries, or it's called Geosophy, or whatever you call it, earth wisdom. And it developed from there. I finished the lay work with a book called The Old Stones of Land's End, preceded by a book called The Earth Spirit, about the nature of the Earth Spirit and its gifts of healing, fertility, and prophecy. And then, since the view of Atlantis was so badly treated by reviewers, one of which, Geoffrey Gregson, said, it's ridiculous to think that the ancient Britons, poorly clad and fed and shivering with cold, would have liked to spend their evening studying the moon, trying to make a living. The old Marxist approach and the Darwinian approach, the two are much related. And I had that sort of review. So I said, well, I'll show them. So I went to Land's End and did a complete survey of all the stones there, which we've heard Cheryl, who's been their guardian, well, for many, many years. She was talking about just before, as you know. It's that area which has the most, I think, the biggest density of megaliths for a small area. It's about 8 by 8 miles. I was able to get maps and put in all the stones which are known and then find others, which sometimes you could do by finding the alignments of them and finding where there's a gap in the chain. And some of there would be a fallen stone. I found several that way and then set out to prove the fact of alignments, which was then subject to statistical tests, particularly a paper read to the Royal Society of Statisticians by Simon Broadbent, the one who'd worked on Alexander Thom's Megalithic Yard. Alexander Thom's book, which came out the same year as my Flying Saucer Vision, was a great step forward because it gave a more evidence for the fact there were alignments, astronomical alignments across the country, as Lockyer had said, as Admiral Somerville had said, as many people had worked on, but it was never officially recognized. So Broadbent tested the incidence of alignments together by chance and so on, and found that it was considerably above chance, but he hadn't actually wanted that result. We hadn't been paid to get it. I think, and so he then finished his paper by saying, yes, but if you were to take away this stain which generates 8 alignments, then it would fall to nearer chance. I had to say, well, Paul, I mean, if you were to put a stone there in the right place, that would increase the number. You can't fiddle around with the evidence like this. And he laughed and agreed, but he'd try and pass it over. But no one really took any notice of it anyway, because they didn't really want it. And that's what's enabled. Well, I'm so glad that was so. It's enabled us to get on in peace, studying these subjects ourselves, and do what Cheryl's doing in West Cornwall, where she's added considerably, she and her readers of her main Mavro has added considerably to the number of stones now known. And at the same time, the stones have been going. When I did the old stones of Land's End, several stones in there have gone since, the smaller ones. But now, thanks to Cheryl and her movement in West Cornwall, she's even appointed local guardians to protect the stones. And they're discovered more all the time. So what a wonderful work that is. I'll go no further but this introduction, but how's the time going? How long have I been speaking? Does anyone know you? Okay, I've not gone too long. But just as Ronald Hutton said this morning, what a great man William Stukeley was. He became my role model when I came across him. What an artist, what an imagination, what a noble mind. He was, I think he was born in 1787, around about then, and he lived to be 80. And the first part of his life, he was secretary of the Society of Antiquaries in London. And he did those wonderful books, first Itinerarium Curiosum, which is an account of his rides across the country in search of curiosities and antiquities. And he was proper megalithomaniac, because he didn't do it alone, he did it accompanied by fellow druids. He formed a sort of order of, well, didn't call them druids, but they took on heroic names from the past. He himself was Canondax, like he called himself the chief druid, and the others took fanciful names, and they enjoyed themselves going around the country, picnicking, doing what you like, and recording, and he was sketching the various items of curiosity around the country. Then he did those two wonderful books, Stonehenge and Avebury, 1730s. He had that gift of being able to draw the monuments pretty accurately and set them in their landscape, something no photographer can do, because he could show the landscape, and even himself drawing it sometimes, as if he's out of the body, and at the same time, accurate kinds of where the monuments were, how they stood in relation to the fields and nature and such, and wonderful drawings of the stones of Stonehenge and Avebury. And he had to, watch while Avebury was destroyed. Ronald was talking about that earlier today. But he actually named the farmer Robinson, who was actually pulling up a lot of them. He had a picture of him too, fierce farmer Robinson, the cruel face he has. This boss was pulling up the stones as Stukeley was watching. And of course, you couldn't reason with such a man. He was one of those get off my land people. Julian Cope was funny. And you remember Julian Cope's book on megaliths? When he gave a lecture here on the town hall, he said he'd been doing a book on megaliths of Europe. And he said, I've been told, get off my land, in 50 different languages. Good man. That's a megalithomaniac. Stukeley was about 40. He had a sort of vision, a change. He began to bring in druids. He began to see that the druids who'd made these great temples of Stonehenge, Avebury, and elsewhere were the true philosophers of the true antique tradition. He called it the patriarchal philosophy because it comes from Abraham and the old patriarchs. And he said, this has been inherited by the Church of England. So he took holy orders and became a rather odd sort of clergyman. And his headquarters actually was in Stamford, which is a very interesting town, because he was said to be one of the old Druid universities. If you go there, you can see the appearance of it as a university town. It was later suppressed by Oxford and Cambridge, but it was the great seat of learning in the time of the Trajan dynasty. You know, the old British rulers who were actually dismissed from history by Camden in the 17th century. But before that, people of Shakespeare's time knew all these old kings, Lear and Hudibras and road builders and such, and they were familiar to everyone in Shakespeare's time. Now you see no account of them, and that's destroyed our whole sort of traditional prehistory, and it should be brought back again. There's so much traces of them around the country, from Brutus landing at Totnes to the University of Stamford to all sorts of places around the country which have historical, which have legendary associations with these old kings. And then Stukeley once said, he got very inspired, he saw the Druids and what it meant for this country, for our destiny. And he said, here the Jews, God's chosen people, are in the best situation anywhere on earth. He said, we've been kind to the Jews. And here we might live to see what many learned men have supposed, that here was to be opened the glory of Christ's kingdom on earth. Well, one of the readers of Stukeley, he was very well read, because everyone got very excited by it, and megalithomania flourished. One of his most ardent readers was William Blake. And Blake's historians never give enough credit to Stukeley, but he took over Stukeley's vision of the winged temple of Avebury and his whole idea of the Druids, and he expanded on it. He did this wonderful poem, his great prophetic poem, Jerusalem, in which he breaks off in the middle to have this is William Blake, to address the Jews. And he wrote, Jerusalem, this is all, as I say, this is all Stukeley inspired. Blake wrote, Jerusalem, the emanation of the giant Albion. Can it be? Is it a truth that the learned have explored? Was Britain the primitive seat of the patriarchal religion? If it's true, my title page is also true, that Jerusalem was and is the emanation of the giant Albion. And then Blake brought in his catchphrase, which he repeats throughout this work. All things begin and end in Albion's ancient Druid rocky shore. And he continues to the Jews. Your ancestors derived their origin from Abraham, Heber, Shem, and Noah, who were Druids, as the Druid temples, which are the patriarchal pillars and oak groves over the whole earth, witness to this day. So Blake's mystical nationalism was derived from Stukeley. It really became our sort of national prophecy. And it's not chauvinistic or limited to England, because Blake said, in my exchange, every land will walk hand in hand together, build Jerusalem. But he said that, but he thought every nation should discover for themselves their ancient traditions and their traditions of being a paradise, of being the holy land of past and future times. I think we show some more slides now. I can keep this and walk through them, because what is a lecture without slides, and what is megalithomania without some of the lovely things to see? Oh, you see that there was a French photographer, I think at the beginning of last century, Roger Violet, who made this wonderful collection of Breton and other great stones, and he always usually had them with people around them. Here you see the little children. Whether he rounded them up and put them there, or whether they were playing there or not, I don't know. But this one, you can't quite see it, but it's had a cross put on top of it. Either it's been cut down or it's been stuck on or something like that, and no one quite knows when. But this is a common thing, that many of these stones were Christianized. You see it in Cornwall, where ill stone crosses are upon these alignments of megaliths and such. And sometimes there's a cross cut into them. Like only in Brittany mostly in Brittany are they sometimes surmounted by crosses. And what lovely shapely things these are, just that they are being dressed, they say. And there are the Breton children playing around it. Here are four. Are they clear? Yeah, well, you know. Again, you see that one, whether he rounded up the children, the girls, by the stone and made them, or whether they were there anyway. It looks as if here they're just showing off for him. Three climbed on the stone, and one little lad having what I suspect may not be his first smoke. And sometimes in Africa, you know, I read a book on African megaliths, and many of them have guardians to this day. They said that they keep the spirits of great chiefs in them. They're the locus of spirit, which gives virility and healing and justice and oracles to the land. So great souls somehow located around or in these monuments. And some of the African stones have guardians to this day, people who descended from these chiefs, whose hereditary duty it is to guard the stones. Rather like Cheryl Strafford pointing guardians for the stones of Cornwall. And there are guardians of stones. I've had many anecdotes of people who go and look at something and some old chap comes up or some woman comes up and tells them all about it. I found that in Ireland too. Without no one's around, someone comes up and tells you about it. Watkins had that experience. He said he was walking a lay he discovered around Cambridge, and he's walking along it. And in the far distance, he saw someone coming up to him. And when they crossed, this countryman said, "Good day to him." And he said, and the countryman said, "You know, this is the old road that goes straight to the mound at Cambridge." And Watkins said, "This is extraordinary. I've just been looking at it. This man comes up to me out of nowhere and tells me the one thing I wanted to know without being asked." So perhaps that gentleman was a guardian. Perhaps she's that's probably the same ones we saw before. I think it is, but you see the cross on top of it. That's in Brittany. And this lovely tall one is in, I think it's in Norway, also by photographed by Roger Violet. And you see, but you can't see, the writing goes up and down. It's a runic writing, I think, which goes up and down it. So it's huge, lovely, tall pillar. I don't know anything about the folklore of even exactly where it is. But it comes in Roger Violet's collection. And there's a men here. I think it's Le Mans Cathedral in France, which has several stones outside, and that's one, with people having fun around it. But which illustrates the old point that Christian or sacred places and buildings were often, as a matter of policy, located upon the ancient temples and sacred sites of the Druid predecessors, perhaps going back many, many, many hundreds and thousands of years. It does seem to be a tradition everywhere to locate sites for new religion upon the old one. And it makes sense, of course, because people are used to coming to these places. That's probably a Christianized man here, and this young lady showing proper appreciation for it. That one I got out of a National Geographic magazine. It's a huge man here. It's somewhere like Vietnam or somewhere like that. I can't quite remember the details, but the story was in the National Geographic, the American soldiers, American authorities had cut down, I think it was a hemp field or an opium field or something undesirable, and thereby they defended the spirits who were lodged within this great standing stone. And the priests are here seen purifying the purifying the rock and getting the spirits back into it again. Because it's an animistic tradition that seems to occur everywhere. But, I mean, but for example, in the Shinto religion of Japan, which is a lovely aboriginal religion, where they have a way of inducing spirit to inhabit a temple with sound. So there was rituals for getting for animating a temple. So I think that seems to be a... And it's usually they're usually spirits of great ancestors or spirits of the dead or local spirits or something from that world which become and these stones or temples become their locus and sanctuaries. That's there again. You see the hint of a. This is one of those Corsican statue men here. Enigmatic, but definitely indicating that they are represent some hero. Stones with holes in them, that's a lovely subject. This one is somewhere in Ireland, it's Wood Martin's Temple and Towers of Ireland, what is it? I can't remember what it's called now, showing this Irish boy looking through this carefully carved stone in a standing stone. Sometimes it's been said they throw a light or you can see through them a certain place on a sight on the horizon where you're meant to see where something's happening in the heavens. Cheryl was showing us the Menantol just now. That's orientated towards the May sunrise. And you can tell it because that line to the May sunrise through the Menantol and through the stone behind it goes precisely along a stretch of parish boundary which is set by little stones. And by the way, many of these boundaries are very ancient, because when land is transferred, it's usually transferred in a block. It doesn't make new boundaries, so the boundaries remain, whether they're parish boundaries or county boundaries or between farmsteads. They're very often very old, and I'll show you some more examples of that. And they very much often occur in this alignment system. And there below, you wouldn't believe what that monument is. It's New Grange before it was, what's the word, fucked up, before it was for it was desecrated by this awful archaeology that went on around it, where it was O'Kelly, wasn't it, who excavated the thing in the usual way, almost down, took off all the roof stones and such, took them to his museum, took the ones he liked which had carvings on them, replaced them by artificial ones, put plastic and cement in the thing, put the roof, dismantle the roof box, put it back in sort of any order, so it's not exactly as it was. And the light beam, which used to come in, which everyone knew and he wouldn't recognize, which used to come in at the midwinter sunrise, is no longer quite does what it used to do, because he's disturbed the archaeology. Then he's put, taken away all these, put pebble dash all around the mound, steel girders, and the stones are stuck on it. It's an atrocity. It's actually, foreign archaeologists were very angry about it. And it was done simply to make the thing into a tourist attraction. It used to be, when I first went there, and when this gentleman was here, and another man inside looking out, you see, probably an Irish archaeologist, look at him. It used to be like that. It was a fairy hill with trees on it, and it was it played a big part in Irish legend and folklore. But now it's a travesty, and the one next door, they're doing the same to it. That's why I like Megalithomania, because you don't do these awful things. You preserve them as they are, and the more atmospheric they are, the better. That's not like a stone with a hole in it. That's the blowing stone. near the pub, but just below the White Horse. It used to be the Berkshire White Horse. Now they've wrongly moved into Oxfordshire, Uffington. And, it was mentioned in Tom Brown's School Days, that's right. And they used to say it was, you blew into it and a deep noise was emanated, came from it, and it gathered the tribes together and such. Maybe, maybe not. But I'd rather choose the most pleasant myth, because you have to have a myth, and you do. Why not choose the one that which is the most beautiful and gives the most pleasure and is most likely? It's probably the most likely one, too. There's some strange effects. The top picture is a Hogarth drawing of architecture. I think it's architecture. And something's happening from some... Can you see a temple there? Yes, there. A ray of light is coming in, and there's a cherub doing something. So it's a kind of allegory of the use of orientation and light, play of light and shadow in ancient architecture, to sacred architecture. And below is an extraordinary feature. I found it in the old Illustrated London News just by chance. I was leafing through years ago. It's a village in Switzerland, Bern. And there's a natural, I think it's a natural hole in the mountains. And the light through that hits the church, the site of the church, on the morning of the day, of the morning of the feast day of the saint to which the church is dedicated. It's very much like what Lockyer said. It was a lovely example of ancient drama and the interplay of light and the wit and beauty used in doing it. The church has definitely been cited there and dedicated for that purpose in succession, no doubt, to some previous temple. And that's Caspar David Friedrich, needs no introduction. That was painted in about 1830, and he captures so, it's called an evening's walk or something, and he captures so well the melancholy which attends a contemplation of past glories, a twilight melancholy, which is such a beautiful thing, and philosophers like it. Caspar David certainly rubbed it in his works, the philosopher's melancholy. It's beautiful, and of course it was part of the whole the German Romantic movement, much of which came from, I think, from Macpherson's Ossian, which appealed to painters and poets throughout Europe, although the scholars never liked it. But as Kathleen Raine used to say, William Blake used to say that the truths and the stories that the scholars don't like, painters and poets got no inhibition about that. They just take the most beautiful of the stories. And the story of Ossian, the great Highland prophet, was no doubt taken from original sources. People used to complain, a lot of it comes from the Bible, but of course it comes from the same source as of sacred literature. And whatever the genuineness of it, rather like the Hermes Trismegistus stuff, which the scholars never approved of it. But romantics and people who liked the beautiful story, painters and such, have always been attracted by it. That's the east end of the West Kennet Long Barrow. That's a path that goes down to the road. And that path actually is very old. It's recently been dug up by English Heritage, or whatever it is, by English Heritage with huge grant from the EU, and destroying that ancient path. It is actually, that path was precisely on the line between the crucial point at Avebury, where that 360/7 line goes through it, and the cove, that the line from there to Stonehenge, precisely a quarter of a degree in length. And that path was actually on it, it's been dug up now. And that pillar, the fourth pillar there, the tall, smoother one, is put up much later than these, because it stands right in front of the entrance and actually blocks the entrance. But it was put up in Bronze Age times, no doubt by the same people who put up the stones of Avebury and Stonehenge, the Bronze Age people, to mark a point. And you can see down the bottom part of it is a groove, goes right down, it's a cut groove, and that marks a 12th part of the distance along that line from Avebury to the Henge. And you see how different. So I say that the Bronze Age people may put something there, it really was in the right place. Oh, this picture I got from, if you can see it, from Wright's drawings of archaeologists at work. Here they are shoveling. They made a bit of a party out of it, do them credit, got the women to see it. They're shoveling away, cutting right through a barrow, moving what they can to, I suppose, to the museum, and then losing it, a lot of it. And then it comes on to rain, so they all huddle in, put up their umbrellas. But the last picture of that series was you just see the barrow completely flat. It's gone forever, as if there's no trace of it. Next generation wouldn't even know it was there. So much has been gone through this ignorance and cupidity and disrespect, which has caused people to destroy these places either for gain or for curiosity, which is never satisfied because you can't tell all that much about anything by destroying a barrow. Thank goodness those days are over, I think. Here we're back to William Stukeley. Now, these are some of his druidical drawings. This was the vernal, is it the vernal equinox? And that's the vernal equinox, and that's the spring, no, the same thing, summer equinox, summer solstice perhaps. And he's drawn a druid with this winged temple. He had this obsession with there being two kinds of temples, the round kind and the winged kind. No one's ever seen these winged kinds before, but I did see one he mentioned in Essex once, a winged temple, and it was winged. He thought Avebury was an example of a winged temple. That to him signified the holy sign of the circle being the creator and the serpent going through it being the spirit of life. But he reconciled it with his own Church of England belief. He said this is the most sacred symbol. And then when he came on to Stonehenge at the vernal equinox, quite what's going on, I don't know what he had in mind. There's a druid sacrificial altar. Someone, man or woman, you can't quite see which, up on a cross. And I've never been able to find it, and the sacrifice on the altar, and some druids around. Quite what he meant by this, I don't know, but it's certainly curious. And then he was walking, the Stukeley was riding through Wales, and he came across a house like that, built round, a living tree. And he said, oh, that's exactly how the house of the chief druid must have looked. So he drew it and put in his book as the residence of the chief druid of his time. See, when we come to Stonehenge, again, is it Megalithomania? Every artist who's been there, every good artist who's been there, and there's been many of them, all the greatest English artists, they always painted it in relation to strange atmospheric effects. Constable painted with a double rainbow and then with storm clouds and other ways, but always dramatically. The bottom one is Thomas Girtin, the beginning of the 18th century, who has these strange light effects. There should be an exhibition, actually, of Stonehenge and the effects of it. When we went there on the natural weather effects around it, when we went there on 2 days ago, some of us went to Stonehenge. We saw it at its most beautiful, with the storm had gone, the light was upon it, and it looked absolutely heavenly. And you could see the light on the whole landscape around. You could see all the barrows and the whole landscape as one. So it was most. I never see it in better conditions than we saw it then. And the top picture, well, I got it again here. Oh, yes, there it is. That's Turner's picture, showing such a dramatic electrical storm around Stonehenge that a flock of sheep and its shepherd appear to have been struck dead by it. It's about as far as you can go in drama, I think, at Stonehenge. There's a lovely picture of the Henge under snow with, I think, John Haddington took this in the next one. And you see along the axis, strange enough, the axis is still is. Still has lintels. It's only section of Stonehenge which keeps its lintels consecutively, and you see the hill stone, the slaughter stone, the hill stone, and then
outlined by the snow, the avenue going straight on to the northeast at an angle of 144 with a line that goes to Glastonbury by way of Gower Hill from the Henge. And that's the angle of a 10-sided figure. And this is one of the points and one of the lines in that I call the circle of perpetual choirs, which is centered upon, the meeting place of three counties, Hereford, Worcester, and Gloucester. And by extraordinary coincidence, Hereford, Worcester, and Gloucester are the three cathedrals which have the Three Choirs Festival. So even now they keep up this Three Choirs Festival around the centre, originally to be in a perpetual choir, which kept going around the around those 12 sections. And it's part of what I call priestcraft, spreading an enchantment over the country, whereby everything is done by custom and time and season and festivals and rote and such. So the years go by very much the same, keeping up a high standard of culture and sacred order, and of course upholding more standards of nature and beauty. And this again is a worldwide science, and we can look back to that as a sort of golden age, if you think that way. And then the next one is, there's the avenue, seen again, but going up to Stonehenge. I have to take it for granted the Stonehenge is at the top. Well, you can see the ring around it. It's been the locus for a great number of the strangest prop circles. And part of this, I mean, prop circles have contributed to this atmosphere of revelation that we've been living in for quite a number of years. Because they're bringing us, well, indications of a lost science. They're very much definitely indicating megaliths. And some of them, like the one I did the little paper on with Alan Brown, Crooked Soley, had the numbers, the chief numbers of ancient science codified in the form of DNA in such an extraordinary way that no one we know could have done it or could have designed it, let alone execute it. So it's a great mystery. But it's worth attending to because it is part of what's going on today when minds are changing very quickly. And in response to necessity, one pattern of life, of reality, is giving way to another, which I think is more in accordance with truth and tradition and will certainly produce a more complete view of life and therefore a more complete order of society than the one which was produced by our industrial society, which is still in force, but is giving way to another one, as witness to which here we are. Oh, a nice picture of old Watkins, sensitive face. And he stood up for what he'd seen. He's a countryman. He didn't let the archaeologist say it's not there, because he knew it was. He'd seen it for himself. And he wrote his books very carefully and very beautifully and very modestly. It's really an object that takes you back into a very nice world to read Watkins's prose and the way he found certain evidence of folk custom and such to support the alignments he was, give life to the alignments which he was finding, which he... And he was badly treated, and the archaeologists wouldn't accept his. But why should they? Let them get on with their own thing. And as long as we've got freedom to study, to pursue things our own way, without then we'll do very well. Classical view of Stonehenge, beautiful view in those arches. That entrance is wider than the average gap between the stones. And the difference is made up by the two on either side, which are slighter. Now, Stonehenge is the most metrological of monuments. I mean, I've done work, and John Neal's done a recent book on the main units of measure and numbers in Stonehenge. It's shown to be a temple range to the astronomers showed it's actually a temple to the two opposites in nature, represented by the moon and sun. In other words, it's a cosmic temple. It reconciles all opposites. There are, as you know, 12 alignments, 8 to the extreme positions of the moon, which there are 8, and 4 to the quarter days of the sun, making 12 in all. And that's one of the most well-known and intriguing images of ancient temples and astronomy, and of course surveying. Charles just spoken about Cornwall, and just show this lovely stone with this lichen, which stands near the Merry Maidens in Cornwall on the edge of a hedge. It's called Goonreath, a stone of blood, I think, and there's some legend about a battle fought in it. And then again, two more stones from the Land's End district. The one at the bottom is, now is Chell here, it's Melfaquite, isn't it? Yeah. And that one stands on the moors just west of the, what do they call it, circle? This three circle. Tregesio, thank you. And from that circle, you can just see the top of that stone. In fact, you can actually sit on it, you can climb up it, you can sit on it. That little girl, Spike Milligan's little daughter, I mean, we went on a lay expedition. We had many expeditions, and some of the people here, John Neal and some of the others, used to come year after year, and we'd investigate, find old stones and look at the alignments and such. But this one is placed there because it takes this alignment over quite a steep ridge, and then below it is, I think it's Wesleyanian quite, which is on that same alignment, which then continues. In the old stones of Land's End, I was able to find quite a number of stones which have subsequently disappeared. Now, in the background here, on that left-hand page, you can see in the background the stones of Boscoinun, that bardic circle in West Cornwall, where the Cornish druids now ritualize in their sky blue robes. Most lovely of the circles. Two or three weeks ago, if you've been there, it's been carpeted with bluebells. Now they've cut back the bracken. It's the most lovely sight and very secluded. And the only stone you could actually see on the ridge at that time from there was this one. Because you see, as we're looking towards the circle, actually we're looking from the circle, you see it standing on a ridge. It's a big stone at its foot. It's placed into. It's only about that high. It's not a great stone. But then if you're coming from the circle from there and you're walking towards it, there it is. But as you get there, the other stone rises above it. My God, there's John Neal on the hedge there. Do you see, just the left of the arrow? No one has that before. How did he get in? Both those stones have now gone, you see. So that alignment, that part of that alignment is now missing. So you can see the stone which supports it there on the ground. That's undoubtedly an old one. But because it's small, it's a mercy if anyone with a tractor and chain who wants to dig it up, either for mischief or for the sake of neatness or whatever. It's a map the wrong way around, actually. My fault. That's actually Boscoinu, and it shows two of the alignments with rings of the points on them which come from it. You can see it more clearly here, because there's Boscoinian circle. You can see the individual stones. And just here, there's a stone which forms a sort of cove. It's got a stone against it. It was a little collection of two stones, called a cove. And that is where the alignments come from. There was a stone there. It's now lying down. There's a missing stone there. There's one there. There's one there, one there, and one at the end. Three of these I actually found myself. And not because they were lined up, because I just happened to notice them at the time and found this very nice alignment of five or six stones, and then shortly after, as you hit the sea, and above you see another line which goes along. There's a little ancient path between fields with two banks, two stone, originally stone walls on either side of it, now being turfed over, and the line goes straight along that road. Making perfectly clear is an ancient processional or ancient way, ritual way or sacred way into that circle. And it's a May sunrise. There you can see the path. I think it's Jan Roberts on the way. And it goes to that stone, the Trismanic pillar, and then on to another one. Then you see they keep popping up. That one I found in a hedge some years ago, actually. And it's been used as... It's where three fields meet. So it's been used as a kind of prop as a ready-made thing to support the hedges which have been built up towards it. So many of them are like that, have been used, incorporated in the hedges, as the Cornish call the stone walls, which get turfed over. We find that to this day, they're difficult, not always easy to recognise until, because many of them have been thrown over. Okay. Well, I think that's it, actually. So what should I say? I think that here in Glastonbury, just spontaneously, we have this conference, we have the Druid revival, we have collections of people who are interested in a wide range of subjects. They have a great and a very wide range of talents. So it's like what is happening is a sort of spontaneous college, like a Druid college, where we can study cosmology, philosophy, and the traditional sciences, which traditionally lead up to initiation. So I think we'll not have a college, but it will develop by itself. You'll be able to, with a meeting like this, and it's now become a tradition, we'll make and a lot of active minds and such around here and around people who are around. So I think that from this will develop what Glastonbury is rarely meant to be, like Jerusalem should be, a place of synthetic learning on all levels. Okay, that's all I've got to say. Yes.
This has been a Megalithomania audio production. For more information, visit megalithomania.co.uk.